You know, while I was working for a group of companies, the last position which I held before I stepped into a full-time business, you know, there were many companies, and I was heading corporate communications there. And so in one of our IT companies, we had a new HR manager. And, you know, one of the things that people do when they join an organization new, especially if they are at the leadership position, they would like to, you know, announce their arrival by bringing in some changes. You know, they will bring in, we have different names for it. One of these names is, you know, best practices, right? So people would, you know, bring some best practice, something that they have done somewhere else. They will try to apply it, and also, you know, sometimes it works, sometimes it may not work for whatever reason. And now this IT company was a very small IT company. There were about 70 odd people, and you know, they had a simple system. People would come and, you know, put their thumb, right, and the biometric would read, and the attendance was taken, and so on and so forth. And so when this gentleman joined in, he was quite amused, and he said, you know, in one of the meetings, he was proposing that everybody in the IT company should have an iCard and an access card, and so on and so forth. And, you know, so everybody was, you know, deliberating on that particular thing. And then actually, when we actually looked at the cost in those days, I'm talking about almost 10 years back, you know, the cost was pretty high because it was not a very popular thing. Not every company had that kind of system. So it was, you know, quite an expensive thing. The whole system had to be, you know, changed, and a lot of investment had to go in. And but then people were considering because, you know, of this kind of suggestion. And so I happened to have a chat with him, you know, after some of these meetings, and I said, you know, I said, Chandru, you know, this what you tell me really seems to be a good idea, but how will it serve us? You know, I mean, what is the value that this would bring to the organization? And Chandru looked at me, and I will never forget what he said. He said, Benjamin, we are an IT company. That's all that he said. He said, Benjamin, we are an IT company. And so I kept back, and I was thinking, okay, so he said, no, you look at all the IT companies, you know, you look at Infosys, you look at TCS, look at Cognizant, right? All their employees wear an iCard, they have an access card. I said, yeah, that's right, but you know, we don't need to have an access card because there are only 70 people. The security guard knows everybody by name and face, right? We have a biometric, and that serves well as far as our attendance is concerned, and also the entry and exit to concern. Why do we need an access card? He said, because we are an IT company. Many times, many times, we do things not really knowing why. We do things not really knowing why. We do things because someone somewhere seems to be doing it. And maybe it is a best practice for someone else. And so we say, let's adapt. And that's also a buzzword, isn't it? Everybody says, you know, there was about 2 decades back, you know, there was a book that Alvin Toffler, I believe, wrote. He said, adapt or perish. And that's what the world will tell you. You know, you need to adapt. You need to change. You need to move on with the times, or you will perish. But every time we do that, chances are that we'll miss what really needs to be done. Chances are that we'll miss what really needs to be done. This morning, as we look at Genesis chapter 26, right? And as I studied this particular chapter, I was able to look at 3 things that the Lord would want us to know. We're going to talk about patterns, we're going to talk about promises, and then we're going to talk about principles. Patterns, promises, and principles. Okay, so even before we go there, let me quickly take you through, you know, what Genesis chapter 26 is, right? It is very similar to Genesis chapter 12 in many, many ways. Okay, there's a famine here, and the word of God particularly talks about in verse 1. He says that there was a famine, and similar to the one that there was a famine when Abraham was there. Okay, and we will come to that reason why scripture is actually making that particular note there. Okay, we'll come to that a little later. But it is very similar to Genesis chapter 12. There's a famine. Isaac decides to go down towards Egypt. He goes to the Philistines, and the king and there's a king called Abimelech, and he goes and he stays there, and you know, he's at that point of time a place near Gerar, and he wants to wait there, and he's trying to go to Egypt, and the Lord intervenes and says, Isaac, don't go to Egypt. Exactly the way it happened to Abraham, right? Only thing is, Abraham actually went further, it says. Now, then the Lord, you know, talks to Isaac, and he reiterates a whole lot of things, all that happened in the past. God tells him again everything, and then Isaac stays there, and while Isaac stays there, he again does something that his father did, and that was lie again about his wife. You know, you remember that story where Abraham did not tell people that Sarah was his wife, because he thought that, you know, she's so beautiful, people will want her and they will kill me, and so better I tell that she's my sister. Isaac kind of repeats that story, okay? It's a repetition of Genesis 12. He does that. Of course, there, you know, the king almost takes Sarah, and she's part of his, you know, palace. But here, that is not the story. It's a slightly difficult thing. The word of God says, Isaac stayed there for a long time. And actually, one day, King Abimelech, looking out of his window, sees Isaac and Rebekah in a very cozy position, right? And therefore, he decides that, you know, she can't be his sister, you know, because that's not how you behave with your sister. And so he comes and confronts Isaac the same way the other king confronted Abraham, saying that, why did you do this to me? You know, you could have, you know, created a lot of problems for us. And then the same way it happened there, it happens here. There's a decree saying that nobody will touch Sarah, nobody will touch Rebecca. And they allow him to stay. He stays there. He multiplies, he grows, he's prosperous. And then the story moves on, right? And then again, you know, people are jealous because he's prosperous. And then Isaac goes around, you know, finding old wells that his father had dug. And he wants to dig those things, and he digs them. And then again, the people are envious because, you know, it's famine, but there is water. And so there's fight. And then Isaac goes from one well to the other, one well to the other, finally, till he reaches a place called Beersheba. And even while he's there, okay, King Abimelech, you know, when he finds his first well, King Abimelech tells him to go away from, he said, go away from us. And then after Isaac goes away, the king and some of his commander, Phicol, actually go back to Isaac and they say, let's have a treaty, because God is with you and we don't want to, you know, get cross with you. So let's have a treaty that you will be good to us because we were good to you, right? Of course, the last pattern, the last few verses actually talks about Esau, saying that, and Esau took other wives from other communities, and he became a pain for Isaac and Rebekah. That's the entire chapter 26 summarizing for you, right? But today we're going to look at patterns, promises, and principles. You know, there is always a story, but there is always a story behind every story. And many times when we don't look beyond the story, we will never be able to understand the real intent, the real reason why certain stories are there in the Word of God. Okay, this is not a storybook. It's a book for us to understand who God is. It's not a book to understand people of God. Many times we mistake that, you know. Yes, there are heroes. There are also villains. There are people who have been great in their faith. There are also people who have let God down terribly. But the idea of all that is for us to understand who God is. Who God is. And today, you know, as we look into this, I want to quickly set the tone for us so that we understand what we're really talking about. What is a pattern? What is a pattern? A pattern is what we call as a repeated design. You know, there is a design that is made. You know, if you know anything about printing, you know, in printing they do that. You know, there is a pattern that is created. Okay, whatever you want to print, the pattern is etched onto a plate. And once the plate is done and, you know, everything is perfect, then it goes to the printing machine, and then the printing machine prints exactly the same thing, whatever number of copies you want. It's a design. And once that design is done, you can have as many copies as you want. It can also be a design for, you know, you are doing a drawing, you know. Many times, you know, my daughter draws something, right? Like a bookmark or maybe. So she will make one leaf, and then she will do the same leaf over and over and again next to each other, and that becomes a pattern. Right? She will make 3 leaves, and then again there are 2 leaves, and then 3 leaves, 2 leaves, 3 leaves. That is a pattern that we're talking about. It's also a model or a formula which can be used as a guide. You know, I'm sure, you know, all the students here will understand that. You know, you have model exams. What is a model exam? It is not the real thing. It is a mock thing, but it is for you to understand the final exam will be like this. This is the pattern of the question paper. You know, there will be so many marks for, you know, your theory, so many marks for your practical. In the theory exam, there will be so many marks for objectives. There will be so many marks. There will be 5-mark question, 10-mark question. You know, that's a pattern, right? And the school and the, you know, the education board will give it to you a couple of times so that, you know, when you finally see that ultimate board exam paper, right, you know, that's how it is. And so many times, you know, schools and colleges also teach the students how to work out with this pattern. Which are the questions you must study? We call it as a blueprint nowadays. I've seen textbooks where there are blueprints that says which chapter has, you know, has how many marks in terms of weightage. Now, I don't know if that's a good thing, because some students are so smart, they say only 2 marks, it's okay. But that's a pattern, that's a formula. You know, you come out with a formula and say, so I know students who says, okay, I will do this chapter, I'll get 10 marks here, I'll do this chapter, 25 marks there, it's very important, this is very important question, I'll do there. So they have a formula, and then you need to have a lot of prayer when you have a formula like that, because if somebody decides that they don't like that pattern, or, you know, they're not going to follow the blueprint, then you are in big trouble, my friend. Okay, even prayers may not be able to help you at that point of time, because, you know, you have a formula. And sometimes formulas don't work. But no, that's very similar to a pattern. And then it's also an example that you follow. Somebody sets an example and you want to follow that. Somebody does something in a particular way. You want to do the same thing. Right? It could be style. It could be fashion. You know, we'll talk about that a little later on. But that's what a pattern is. So in essence, if you want a definition, a pattern is a regularity in the world, man-made design, abstract ideas, elements of a pattern repeat in a predictable manner. It's very predictable, right? 2 plus 2 is 2 here, 2 plus 2 also will be 3 here, 2 here, right? We are looking for a 2, but many times it's possible that sometimes you may have a 3 plus 1, which is also the same as 2 plus 2, okay? But that's where, you know, the issue is. Pattern needs to be observed and followed and, imitated. That's what a pattern is. You know, when you have a pattern, you have to observe it carefully so that you are able to get it, then you follow it. Or you imitate, you observe somebody and you imitate that. You know, the style, the way somebody talks, the walks and something like that. Principle, on the other hand, is a little different thing. Okay, principle is something different. Principle, by definition, is a fundamental truth or a proposition that serves as a foundation for a system of belief or behavior or for a chain of reasoning. Lot of words there, but let us quickly break it down. Okay, it's a foundation, means it is a basis. That is the basis for what you do. That's the basis for your belief. Why do you believe what you believe? This is a foundation. Okay, why should you believe what I'm saying? Don't believe. Go back to the foundation. Okay, if somebody preaches without this, don't even bother to listen to that person. There is no foundation. We may have patterns, but this is a very different foundation. It's a foundation in which we believe. It's also a rule or a belief governing one's behavior. Another way of looking at it is a fundamental source of basis for something. Well, a principle is a concept or value that is a guide for behavior and evaluation. It's also kind of a law. It's a rule, and it makes sure that every time you don't follow it, you don't understand it, you know, there's a problem. Now, pattern needs to be observed and followed and imitated, but a principle needs to be understood, believed, and translated into action. Okay, a principle, first of all, needs to be understood, because if you don't understand the principle, very difficult. You know, mathematics is the same thing. You know, many students in mathematics, what they want to do, they somehow want to get the answer. And so, one, you look at one problem and you have done it, and you want to do the same thing in the next problem because you somehow believe that it's a pattern. But no, mathematics is not with patterns, it is with logic. And logic is a principle. If you don't understand the principle, you will look at every problem as similar, but the answers you will never get the right answers. Now that's the difference between pattern and principle. Now, looking at, you know, humans, you know, it's very easy to follow a pattern. Very easy to follow a pattern. You know, man has always tried to follow some patterns or the other. If you look at, you know, God had given man a command and a freedom, you know, in the book of Genesis chapter 1, you know, and 2, God created man, he gives him a command, he's saying, everything is there, enjoy, free, fun, great. One tree, don't touch it. One command, whole lot of freedom, right? But when the devil doubted God, now look at this, I'm taking you back to Genesis 1, 2, sorry. When the devil doubts God, you know, he sets certain things in motion, you find that Eve follows suit. You know what Eve does? She also starts doubting God. And there you see, the principle is there that, you know, God created me, God gave me a command, right? And God told me not to touch it, okay? But I don't understand it. Now I'm beginning to doubt it. Why? Because somebody else is doubting. Because somebody has a better argument. And so they doubt it and she doubts it. And then when Eve eats the fruit, what Adam says? He also eats the fruit. Why? Because anyway, it's now done. You know, already she ate the fruit. Let me also taste it. You see a pattern there? Right? When God confronts Adam and Eve, you know, Adam blames Eve. Okay? You know what Eve does? She blames the serpent. Again, you find a pattern there. The Bible is full of examples of how people have followed a pattern and how it has let them down. A pattern, you know, pattern lets you down because a pattern does not need conviction. You can follow a pattern without conviction. You can do it because everybody is doing it. There's no need for conviction. You know, it's the easy thing. It's the in thing. It does not need thinking or analyzing or, for that matter, any cognitive function. It just needs for you to follow, copy, imitate. We are in a world where we live our lives with control C, control V of some behavior, some mannerism, some style which someone else is doing or has done. Pattern. But my friend, pattern will let you down. Pattern without a principle will let you down. And that's what we are going to see in Genesis chapter 26. But before that, the people of Israel always fell into sin when they followed the pattern of those around them. You know, when you look at the Old Testament, at every point of time, you know, that's why God says, you know, don't mix with them. Don't give your daughters to them. Don't take your sons. Why? Because it is very easy to follow somebody else's pattern, somebody else's custom, somebody else's, you know, doing. You know, when you look at 1 Samuel chapter 8 and verse 5, you know, that was the time when Israel asked for a king. You know, they're talking to the prophet and says, you know what, give us a king. You know why? Because everybody has a king. They were desperate to follow a pattern. Even Jesus' disciples fell for this pattern problem. Look at John 21 and verse 3. Okay, Jesus was crucified. He was risen. But in that time, you know, it says Peter, you know, he was the man, he's the leader, you know, the most vocal. Peter told them, I'm going to fish. And they said, we will go with you. And so they went and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Somebody of influence does something, we may want to do it. Now, when you come to, you know, Isaac, there's something about Isaac that we must understand this. You know, if you look at it, you know, the word of God gives about, I think, 14 chapters for Abraham and approximately 12 chapters for Jacob. And in between, sandwiched between Abraham and Jacob, is Isaac, who gets one chapter for himself and a couple of chapters where he has to share space with everybody else. The next chapter, chapter 27, you'll find Isaac plays a little bit of role. So he probably has about 25% of that chapter to him. The rest, 75%, is all other people. Right? In the previous chapters, you'll find, you know, the only mention of Isaac is here and there. It starts with, you know, long back when Isaac went with Abraham to the hill. There's a little mention about Isaac there. But otherwise, the only thing that everybody will remember about Isaac is that he waited for his wife while he was preparing, and that's about it. Right? And very few mention about it. So actually, if you look at it in the Word of God, Okay, we are in the middle of Genesis, chapter 26. It's a chapter devoted to Isaac. Only one chapter. Now, there is something that we must understand. Isaac is sandwiched between two greats. On one side, he has a father who is a superman of faith, Abraham. Right? Then he has another son who is a superstar, Jacob. In between is Isaac. There is nothing much that we get to know about him. Just this one chapter. Right? So I wanted to just think about this, and as we go through it, it will make sense to everybody. Now, today we see patterns as a success formula as well. Okay? Now, here are some of the things that I'm going to tell you. I want you to listen to me with a pinch of salt if required. Patterns that we may follow as a success formula. Number one, family traditions. We have always done this in our family. This is the way we are. We have been. We will be. It's a pattern. Be very careful. Cultural expectations, young people. The culture will tell you to do some things. And there's an expectation. If you're not following that pattern of the world, you may be left out. But if you follow the pattern of the world, you will be accepted. You will be honored. You may even become successful. Right? It's a shortcut to success. Cultural expectation. Choice of profession. Like father, like son. Father is a doctor, son has to become a doctor. Father is a businessman, son has to become a businessman. Not skipping even church. If father is a pastor, then the expectation is son has to follow suit. Son has to become a pastor or at least do something in full-time ministry. Because it's a pattern. Okay? Or a missionary or a teacher. You take any profession, we would like that to happen. We'd like to see it happen. Right? Parents are great. So we say, therefore, children also have to be great. Like the parents. So there's always a comparison and there's a pressure to follow that pattern. Right? But there are other formulas also. For example, nowadays, young people have this thing where you want to do this pattern thing in a different style. It's a success formula. What's a success formula? Go abroad, get a degree. It'll make you successful. Be very careful. It's only a pattern. Not everybody who gets a degree abroad is successful. Some of them are doing a lot more other things than what they studied for. Just that they can't come back for whatever reason. Be very careful about that. Buying a car, buying a particular type of car. Okay? Sometimes it's also family pressure. In our families, everybody has this car. So you also need to have a car. Pattern, be very careful. Admission for children in a particular school. I want my child to study in that school only. Why? Because my friend's child is studying there. My neighbor's child is studying there. Or you want to stay in a particular locality, in a particular kind of, apartment, whatever that may be. Right? Then we have other formulas. You do an engineering, then do an MBA, settled my life. Okay? Or, you get into an IT job, you go to USA, settled. Do you know all these patterns? It's all there, everywhere. People talk about it. Right? By the way, all these patterns set by others that we can be happy to follow as a formula to maybe to get us better jobs, opportunities, or successful, or sometimes avoid trouble. Sometimes we also follow patterns because we don't want to get into problems with people. We said, "Edukuma, let's do it, finish it off." Right? But the word of God would stand and confront you saying, that is not how God would want your life to be. And that's what he wants to tell us this morning. What is God's pattern? If you have read the Bible at least once, or if you know some parts of the Bible, what do you think is God's pattern? Does God have a pattern? Well, any one of you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think God has only one pattern. That he has no pattern. You can never predict our God. Yes, he is good. But his goodness can come in various shapes, forms, and sizes. God is good. Maitri is doing very well. Praise God. But auntie also talked about 8 people who lost their lives. And she said, God is still good. Where is the pattern? There is no pattern. God gave you... she's not here. No, God gave Kathy a guitar. She'd been praying for a long time. God gave her a guitar. Great. But there are some others here. You have not been praying. So you have been praying for a long time. And some of your prayers are not answered. Is God not good to you? Does God need to give you a guitar to prove that he is good? If God does something for him, should he do it for me? No. God says, that's not how I work. And if you look at the word of God, you know, God has never done the same thing again. Never. Even the way he deals with people is not the same thing. The way he dealt with Abraham, he didn't deal with Isaac. And the way he dealt with Isaac, he is not going to deal with Jacob. Because God will work with us according to our need, according to his plan, not according to any pattern. And that is the only pattern that God follows. That we can never say, I know my God, this is what he's going to do. You will be terribly wrong, my friend. You know, we are not saved in the same pattern. Some people are saved in a dramatic manner. You know, there's a lightning, there's tingling of bells. You know, there is, you know, expression of the, you know, of the spirit within you and so on and so forth. Some people have been saved through grace, sitting in a quiet corner in their home. Nobody. And nobody knows. But God met that person and called that person from darkness into light. Where's the pattern? There is no pattern. You know, long back I was listening to one of Ravi Zacharias' message, and he said, I remember that, he said, you know, there was a man who stole a music system from a car. And in that music system was a message of Ravi Zacharias. That man went, heard the message, and came to know the Lord. He didn't need a revival meeting. He didn't need a gospel meeting. He didn't even need a church. God can save anybody, anywhere, anyhow. But it is we who always want God to be in a pattern. We want to box God in a pattern, say, this is how God should work. No. God says no. My ways, that's why he says, my ways are much higher. I mean, we can't even imagine. We can't even, you know, even in our fantasies, we will never even touch the place where God starts thinking. Some people, God meets them on their deathbed. There are some others, he meets them when somebody else is dead. God does not deal with people the same way. Even the way God answers prayers and speaks to us or works in us is different. We can never put God in a box. In Genesis chapter 26, we find four things that Isaac does. You know, the slide will talk to you about that. Okay, Isaac is trying hard to follow the pattern of his great father Abraham. And he does almost everything as far as possible to the T. And in doing that, he's almost missing the point. But praise God, God does not give up on Isaac. And God responds to Isaac with promises and principles when Isaac wants to follow a pattern that is set before him. Four things. If you look at verse 2, Isaac goes to Egypt. Verse 7, he's lying about his wife. Verse 18, he's digging wells because Abraham dug the wells. And verse 31, he also enters into a treaty with the heathens because Abraham also did that while he was alive. Look at God's response. These are the four things that, you know, we're going to look at, okay? Broadly what Isaac did, but we're not going to focus on Isaac this morning. We're going to focus on God because scripture is about God. Look at God's response. Number one, God responds to Isaac. He reminds Isaac of the promise he made to Abraham. If you look at verse 2, he says, I will be with you and bless you, for to you and to your offspring, I will give this land. He makes it personal with Isaac. God is telling Isaac, yes, you know, I made a covenant with Abraham, Isaac, but you don't have to have a second-hand understanding of that command. I am going to deal with you now. And he says, yes, I told Abraham, but now I'm telling you. You don't need a pattern. You need a promise, and I'm promising you, God says, that I will bless you, and I will give it to you and your offspring. He says, verse 3, you know, I will establish the oath that I swore to Abraham, your father. I made a promise to him, but I'm doing that same promise to you. Hold on to the promise, Isaac. Forget the pattern. Because a pattern can let you down, God's promise will never let you down. Young children, young friends, you know, God's promise will never let you down. But I don't think anybody can give you a guarantee saying that, do this much, you will get it. It can fail you. It can fail you. But God's promise will never fail you. God reminds Isaac also about his plan. If you look at verse 4, he says, you know, he tells Isaac, you know, why I want you to stay here. You know, there's a reason for it. He says, Isaac, I will multiply your offspring as the stars of the heavens and will give to your offspring all these lands. That is why I'm telling you, stay here. Don't go here and there. And then he says, and in your offspring, all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. That is my plan, Isaac. I want you to understand my plan. You don't have to do everything that your dad did. You know, many times it's possible that we are doing the same mistakes that our parents are doing. No parent is perfect. No parent is perfect. But sometimes when we follow, you know, many times, you know, we see that it is always easy to follow somebody's wrongdoing than to follow somebody's right doing. You know, I read the Word of God almost every day. But that does not mean that, you know, my children will imitate me in that area. But if they see me watching TV a lot, my son will be very quick to imitate me there. Okay, I wonder why he does not imitate me in studying the Word of God. Patterns will fail us, but God's plan, God's promises will never. The third thing is, you know, God also reminds Isaac of the principles that Abraham followed. He talks to him about the promise, he tells him about his plan, and finally God says, I'm going to lead you to understand the principles that your father understood. And if you understand the principles that your father understood, then you will be able to live your life even better than what your father lived his life. And that's where we come to this thing. We are looking at verse 5, he says, now look at verse 5, what he says. He says, because Abraham obeyed my voice. Now look at, you know, whenever you study the Bible, if something is repeated, you must be sure that it is there for overemphasizing. And when something is overemphasized, we have to look at it 100 times. Because it's very important. Now, if you look at that word, now God is, you know, lot of I and lot of me and lot of my is what God is telling you, right? But he means business there. Now, look at all the my's in that particular verse 5. He says, Abraham obeyed my voice and kept my charge, my commands, my statutes, and my laws. Why is he telling Isaac that? Because he wants Isaac to understand. If you want to understand why your father did whatever he did, especially the good things, then you need to understand what your father understood. Abraham lived his life of faith because he understood God and he understood how God works. And God works on those principles. And when you understand the principles of God, you can make the right decisions in your life. You don't need a pattern to follow. You just need God to follow. That's why God is telling Abraham, Isaac. Number one thing, the first principle, godly principles. You know, we look at this chapter. Number one, okay, Isaac goes about lying about Rebekah. And then, you know, King Abimelech finds out. And then, you know, you look at that particular thing happening. The first principle, okay, we all need to understand. Principle number one, your sin will find you out. Your sin will find you out. Numbers chapter 32, verse 23. Numbers chapter 32, verse 23. Go home and read that. Okay? Because we think we can do whatever we want and we can hide everything from everybody and somehow we can, you know, make our way and nobody will know. There's a very famous saying, you can fool, you know, people at some time or other, but you can't fool all the people all the time. But the Word of God says, even if you are able to fool all the people all the time, still you cannot fool God. And God will bring to light what you have done in darkness. My friend, this is very important. Your sin will find you out. Your sin will find you out. Isaac thought it was a good idea, just a small lie. Anyway, by definition, somehow I can prove to people that she's my sister. Well, she was his, in a way, the cousin sister, right? But that was not the full truth. The truth is she was his wife and he was lying from everybody. But his own actions betrayed him, and his sin found him out. Don't think, never think that we can get away with sin. We can never get away with sin. It will come back to haunt us someday or the other. And that's why we need to deal with sin in the way God would like us to deal with. God says the axe has to be at the root, not at the fruit. Deal with your sin. Your sin will find you out. That is principle number one. Principle number two, what is not possible with man is possible with God. Luke chapter 18 and verse 27, that's where Jesus says, yes, it is difficult for you, young man. You're a rich young man. It's not possible for you. But he says, what is possible with God? What is impossible with man is possible with God. You know what? It was a year of the famine. That's why he goes from one place to the other. There is still famine there. People are still struggling. God blesses Isaac. It says, Isaac planted and he got 100-fold in the same year. Now, if you know something about agriculture, you know that doesn't really happen. You have to till the land and you need a lot of water. And you move towards 100% only in some time, after one or two crops, when the ground really becomes great. But God says, when Isaac did it, within a year, in the same year, he got 100-fold. What is impossible with man is possible with God. I don't know what is your problem this morning. But don't look to solutions looking at a pattern. Don't say that if I do this, I can do that. One of the things that most people, financial problems many people have. And many times, instead of praying, we would rather get a credit card and trust a credit card than trust God. Okay? I know a principle, it's not in the Bible, but I can tell you that. And I tell all the people who try to sell me cards, a credit card will never make you rich. It will give you the feeling of richness, but it is destroying you from inside. A credit card will never make you rich. It will definitely make you poor because you are spending what you don't have. God, on the other hand, is waiting to bless you. If you think you need a credit card to survive, you are following the pattern of the world, my friend. You don't need a credit card. You don't need one. If that's the pattern of the world, cut your card this today. As an act of faith, go home today and cut your card. Deal with it. Throw it and say, God, I'm going to trust you. And if your God is not faithful to you, come and tell me, I will renounce this God. Because I am asking you to live your life on a foundation, not on a pattern, not on a scheme, but on the foundation that God is faithful, even when we are not faithful. Unconditional faithfulness of God. Would you try this morning? Some of you maybe, at the last minute, somebody will give you a chit. 5-mark theorem. It's in your pocket. Would you trust God or follow a pattern? And if some of you are really, really lucky, you may get a center where actually a teacher will allow you, saying, okay, last 10 minutes, you want to copy, you copy. I've been in situations like that. What will you do? It's a pattern of the world. Authorized time for copying. Would you copy? Maybe somebody gives you a slip of paper. Would you do that? Or chuck it, saying that that's a pattern of the world. I'm going to look at God. What is impossible with man is possible with God. Would you dare to live by a principle than a pattern? The next principle we see is about all the efforts that Isaac takes in digging all the wells. The principle comes from Psalm 127 and verse 1. It says, unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labor in vain. Unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labor in vain. Blessings and prosperity are good, but only when God blesses them. Which means it is possible to have prosperity even without God. You don't need God for prosperity, But what you really need God for is to be able to enjoy that prosperity, and that prosperity to actually become a blessing rather than a curse. That is where God makes a difference. You know, if your prosperity is without peace of mind, you can be sure there is no God in it. Because God will not give you prosperity and headache and anxiety and worry. That's not the way God operates. You know, thinking about it, you know, I'm just going to give an example, but this is true for everything else, okay? This is the pattern that I'm talking to you about. People make money for various reasons, okay? Number one, people make money for money. Okay? They make money because they will use the same money to make more money, and they'll be happy that they can make more money. Pride. So people make money because pride. Okay, next one. People make money to pay bills. Okay? And why? Because we have possessions. We go around and buying a whole lot of things. We want to buy a lot of things. We want to possess a lot of things. And every other person is giving you EMI today. You have EMI for everything. Right? So buy now, pay later. So then you have to make money to pay your bills. And then you make money to spend. Okay, why? You want to spend on yourself. You want to spend on something that is important to you. Your passion. You want to spend money on that. Nothing wrong in all these things, but by the way. But look at the pattern. And then there are some people who make money to be a blessing. And that's purpose. So you can make money for pride, you can make money for possessions, you can make money for passions, or you can make money for purpose. The same thing is for anything else. Academics. You know, some people would study and study and study. Now, you can get all the degrees for the sake of degrees. And tell everybody that I have 26, 30 or 34 letters after my name. You know, you have to put additional sheet if you want to write my name. Pride. Sometimes that education has no value for anybody, including that person. Then you can have academics, you know, because it gives you certain things, right? You can possess a position. Isn't it? You know, in the government, in banks, you know, if you clear a particular exam, you'll get a promotion. So why you are clearing the exam? Very simple. You want a promotion. That's why. You don't care what is there in the exam. Somehow you have to pass. You pass the exam, you get a promotion. Right? But sometimes you can gain academic knowledge for spending. Okay? And because that's your passion. You want to get into research. You want to find out new things and do that. Yes. And then you can get academic qualification to be a blessing. You say, I'm doing this because there's a purpose. God has put on my heart. And that's why I'm doing this. I mean, if God calls you to go to North India before you do a Bible theology college, I think you should first go and learn Hindi. Does it not make sense? But we will not learn Hindi. You know, we will learn Bible theology and go there without knowing Hindi and then challenge God to do the impossible. Right? And struggle. Unless the Lord blesses. Unless the Lord builds. Okay? Let's be very careful with what we are running after, our pursuits. Look at what Isaac was doing at very quickly. You know, Isaac and his people were trying. They were digging up wells. They looked at the past. You know, Abraham had done this. Let's go. Let's get it. You know, let's go and dig our old wells. Okay, the first well, verse 14. Okay, the moment they dug it, they got some water, famine. Remember, people have everything. Isaac is becoming very rich. People are always envious. You know, the envious goes to jealousy. And they openly come and tell, please get out from here. We don't want you in our midst. So he digs a well, gets the wealth, he gets water, but he has to go away from there. Okay? Verse 14. Then the second well, he goes a little further and he goes and digs the well again there. Right? He calls, but there people come and accuse him, you know. They come and have arguments with him. And there's a fight between his people and their people. So there's a lot of problems. Right? And he actually calls that place Esek, which means accusation or a lawsuit. If you look at the Greek meaning there, it's a lawsuit, it's what it says. And then the third well, okay, the third well in verse 23, you find that at this point of time, the problem had gone from jealousy to opposition to accusation, right? And a lot of problems there. It digs a well. Again finds water. Again the problem. Right? And then actually, you know, he calls that place Sitna, which means enmity. Look at the degree. It's just going high and high. And then finally, he goes further. And in verse 23, they dig a well and they find water again. He found water every time. And then he says, Rehoboth. He says, which means wide open spaces. There is room. God is making space for me. There is enough space for me to cohabit with these people. And still he goes further to a place called Sheba. And in between that place, before this fourth well and the fifth well, is when Abimelech and his people come to have a treaty with him. Isaac treats them properly, greets them, makes an oath with them. And then the word of God says, the very same day, you know, they stay overnight. Early in the morning, these guys get up. They have the ritual of the oath ceremony and they go. And as soon as they go, his people come and tell him, the very same day, they say, we dug and we found water. And Isaac says, God has restored it. And he calls that place Sheba. And eventually, that place will be called Beersheba. You know, Proverbs 6, verse 30 to 31, it says, the Lord will cause your enemies to restore back seven times what has been stolen from you. There's another verse that says, if your ways are right before God, this is not a pattern, my friend, it's a principle. If you are right with God, even your enemies will come and reconcile with you. But we need to be right with God. We don't have to be right with our people. First, we have to be right with God. Because that will define every other thing. The fourth principle that we get from this particular passage. We have talked about three principles there. Okay, if you go to the next slide. Yeah, the three principles are there. The fourth principle is, in all things, God works for the good of those who love him and who are called according to a purpose. If you believe that you are called according to a purpose, and as a response to that purpose, you love God, you can be sure that all things, meaning all things, will work together for good because God is in charge. Nothing will be against you. God will be in charge of everything. God was bringing Isaac back to the promised land. What looked like an upset was actually a setup for Isaac to come back from the land of Philistines to the land where God had intended for Isaac to live. You know, God will do anything to get you back. He will even create enemies so that you are not able to be there and you have to come someplace else. God can even give you a failure. God can give you a setback. God can give you a trial in our lives. God can even give us illness. The idea is not to torture us. The idea is to get us back so that we don't miss out on what God is telling us. That is his principle. What are some of the patterns in your life, my friend? You know, what patterns do we follow? You know, in our life, in our faith, in our families, what is the pattern? Okay. God is a pattern breaker. God wants to break that pattern. Maybe there's been a pattern of telling lies. Maybe there's been a pattern of hiding things. Maybe there's been a pattern of deception. This morning, God wants to break it, my friend. God says, my child, I'm going to give you a promise and I'm going to help you understand my principles and I'm going to help you break that pattern in your life so that you don't have to go round and round in that same thing, but I want to break you free for eternity. Is our worship a pattern? Sometimes if we have a pattern, we can just make it happen. You know, we don't even need God. We can create worship even without God. Let's be careful. What about our giving? Do we have a pattern in our giving? Just give him 10%. You know, he will take care. God is not interested in our 10%. God is not even interested in our 100%. God is interested in us. You remember that verse in Galatians? He says, before they gave themselves to the Lord. That's what God is really interested in. I mean, even the money that you and I can give back to God is from God. Are we aware of the patterns that we are following from our forefathers, you know, in our families? Okay? Patterns of curse, patterns of maybe blessing, patterns of maybe doing the right things. You know, sometimes we are proud that, you know, for four generations we have served the Lord. Really? Or are you served your pride that you have served for four generations? Check it. Is it necessary that your son or your daughter has to do the same thing that you are doing? Is it possible that God can have a different plan for your child? Is that a possibility? Look at scripture. Understand the principle. What is our pursuit? What are we pursuing in our life? Is it based on a pattern that we see around the world? Are we doing things? Are we conforming to the pattern of the world in our thinking, in our speaking? Young people, you know, it's very easy. We tend to pick up language. We tend to pick up slang. We tend to pick up certain things, but everybody else is talking. Why? Can the words that come out of our mouth be a blessing to people rather than just be a pattern of the world? And finally, for some of us, are you digging old wells? Is God waiting for you to move from where you are to where God wants you to be? But you are there stuck because of a pattern. It's been like this. We have done like that. And I'm going to do it like this. Would you allow God to break into your life this morning? Shall we bow down our heads and look to the Lord in prayer? Lord, we believe, Lord, that you have opened our eyes. We believe, Lord, that you have revealed yourself to us in a very different way, Lord, this morning. We thank you, Lord, for your promise, O Master. The promises that we have been holding on to for so many days, so many months. We want to thank you, Lord, for that. We want to thank you, Lord, for showing us some of the principles that we can live our life by, O Master. But Lord, this morning, very specially, we come into your presence, Lord, and we want to surrender those patterns in our life, Master, which may not be in sync with your design, which may not be in sync with your promises, which may not be in sync with your principles, O Lord, Master. O Father, convict us, Lord, this morning. If there is any pattern in our life that is destroying us, that is putting you to shame, Lord, we pray. We humbly seek you, Lord, that you will break it in our life, O Master. Break every pattern that does not belong to you. Lord, we pray that you will break every pattern that belongs to the world. Break every pattern that is taking us away from you. Break, Lord, every pattern that is preventing us from trusting you, for preventing us from putting our faith on you, Lord Master. Break every pattern, O Lord, that is stopping us from doing what you want us to do, O Master. Maybe the pattern of a job that we are seeking, the pattern of a lifestyle that we are seeking. Lord, have mercy on us, Lord. Lord, we pray, break those patterns in our life, Lord Master. Have your way in us, O Master. Have your way in us. We thank you, Lord, for your grace that is upon each one of us this morning. Lord, we pray that as we go out from this place, we will go out renewed. We will go out restored because you have a promise and you have a principle for each one of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.